The question that came to me for this week was, does God need forgiveness? Last week we talked about forgiveness and how complicated the process of forgiveness can be for human relationships and for faithful relationships. And while I think we can all agree that it is clear that as humans we need to continue to seek forgiveness from God, the question is, does God ever need to seek forgiveness from us? Now I realize that's a pretentious question. I mean, who really would be willing to say, hey, God, Almighty, Sir, Man, Divine Entity, you need to say sorry. Yet as I reflected on the pain that was felt from this congregation on the death of the family of five, and the ongoing other losses that seemed cruel and unnecessary in this time of chaos, I found myself asking this question and needing to stop, regroup. When my brain begins to fill with all of these theological questions of why, I will not and have not allowed myself to allow cliche answers to suffice. I need something much deeper in my own personal life so that I can respond to others. I need to know that God is going to be sufficient. And if I'm honest, sometimes it doesn't feel like God is sufficient, even if I know better. Especially when we are in the midst of experiencing tragedy, loss, and chaos. So I took time to think even about the sermon series that came from our Lenten series on the shack. I realized that sometimes I still kind of feel the need for God to say, I'm sorry. I'm sorry for the pain. I'm sorry for the hurting. I'm sorry for the loneliness and the questions and the hungry and the chaos. I know for myself and sometimes even for other people that they need to hear that type of apology. And even then, if I don't get from God or if they don't get a direct I'm sorry from God, I need to know that God is able to help me through the process that brings me back to recognizing, knowing, and naming and a loving and amazing God. In some ways, I need to know that mountains can be moved. And I want to say the doxology that we say each week and truly mean it. I want to say, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. But how do we say that when the kingdom sometimes looks really bleak? The power seems weak. And there seems to sometimes be no glory. And while last week we took time to recognize that we will often fail God, we must sometimes openly admit, even if it's pretentious, that it doesn't always look like the mountains are able to be moved. That we feel like something is not working with us. And we must name it if we are to have an open relationship with God. So that, like any relationship, we can start to move through the suffering and the questions and the pain in conversation and in emotions, move back to an authentic relationship with God. Just like last week where we talked about how love and forgiveness is a process that we must continue with our conversations with God to live a life of faith when we often seem trapped by immovable emotions. When I first encountered today's scripture, when I was much younger, my conclusion solution was that we as humans will never have enough faith, even as small as a mustard seed. We will never have enough faith to truly move mountains. And thus we must blame ourselves, our human frailties, once again for not being enough. That we as humans will always have too much doubt, and that it is our fault that nothing moves. Yet as I've gotten older, I've realized that an abusive type of thinking does not actually reflect what a God of love would do. So I began to switch it up. Let's take a totally different approach to this scripture and start to think about it in a completely different way. Let's say for a moment that God is sorry. That instead of being this non-relatable being that stands like a genie waiting to grant our wishes, or a puppeteer who moves us around, God is actually big enough, great enough, and wise enough to sometimes say to us, "I am sorry." And not only can we look and see ways that God has said sorry, but if we look closely, because of recognizing this, we, along with God, might have actually moved mountains. Figuratively and literally. Just like all the parables from Jesus that we know, they have multiple layers. And the mountain image in this scripture can definitely be twofold. I mean, when we think about mountain moving, when we think about mountain moving, we think of it flattening and shifting in this specific place and time. Maybe, however, that's limited human thinking. I mean, that seems more like a cool Hollywood act of power and not a real human long-term response needed when engaging in an emotional world that really needs to know much more profound ways to move mountains than just explosions. And so I thought about the mountains that really are a part of our faith lives that hold us back from when being able to connect to God. We have on this list death and failure, people who are hungry and hunger, fear and worry, injuries and loneliness, war and illness. These are just the top mountains in our lives and in our worlds that we continuously have to struggle with, to respond to. It's not just a physical mountain, it's an emotional and real place of how do we continue in this difficult life. And yet, scholars will point out that it is highly probable that Jesus may have been referring to an actual mountain. The area around Jerusalem has lots of mountains, and on one of the mountains stood a temple, the temple. The other possible reference is to the Mount of Olives. In chapter 13, which is the chapter after the scripture we read today, Jesus gave what is called by scholars the Olivet Discourse. There are many biblical references to this mountain. And so it was interesting to start to examine what we know about the Mount of Olives. And in doing that, I began to see what maybe the disciples were able to understand, to have the tools that can actually strengthen our faith and move mountains. Move the mountains that strengthen our faith with God. Just like the 10 best ways to live were given on a mountain, we continue to have God try to find ways for us to be best in community with one another and with God. So on the Mount of Olives, what we first know is there is a reference to it where David was leading his people in tears up the side of the mountain. We later hear in the Hebrew scriptures, Solomon used the Mount of Olives as a place of idol worship. Thus, the first stories that we kind of know in our faith these days deal directly with this place, include a mountain where people have wept and idols have been worshipped. Jesus shift the images of this mountain quite dramatically. It starts to become a much more sacred place. Lazarus, Mary, and Martha lived near this mountain, so Jesus would often spend time with friends here. It's often referred to as the place where Jesus would go to pray and spend time with God. It was here in the Garden of Gethsemane on the Mount of Olives where Jesus was arrested and betrayed by his friends. This mountain is also the place where Jesus would share insights like the Olivet Discourse with his disciples and his followers. Those who knew him came to this place to watch him and celebrate him and shout Hosanna as he rode into Jerusalem. And this place, the Mount of Olives, is also where Jesus would ascend to heaven. Just like when we talked about the shack, and as we look at today's scripture, how do we as people of faith move mountains? Well, it's by following and knowing and engaging in a relationship with Jesus Christ. By doing that, our faith in God becomes stronger. Because even when you know tears and places of idol worship, you know that in those places there can be change, things can move and be shifted. And if you look at the story of Jesus, we are reminded that God said sorry. And God does say sorry. God continues to say sorry, not in a way of woe is me, but in a way of I love you so much that I am able to meet you there. That I, God, have a love for you that continues to be the best. And I've shown it to you in the best way through Jesus Christ. That God has shown us how God is able to relate to us on a human level, even in moments where we ask the hard, pretentious questions. God is able to move mountains by building relationships and continues to find the best ways to live in relationship with God and with one another through Jesus Christ. And so ask yourself, did the mountain move? And for me, the answer is yes, but how did it move? It moved in faithful ways. And there's a quote that says, faith can move mountains, but don't be surprised if God hands you a shovel. And we have been shown how we are able to use that shovel because Jesus showed us. Moses showed us, and that wasn't enough. So Jesus comes along and shows us again. And we do it because the emotional things that are happening in our lives, the wars, the illnesses, the loneliness, are able to be overcome, and God is able to be recognized when we have friends who support us. When we teach our friends and others about God. When we remember there are moments when we must go by ourselves to pray. And there are moments when we will be recognized as kings. And even more difficult moments where we will be betrayed by those closest to us. Yet even in all of those moments, Jesus on those mountains, on that mountain, remained focused on God. And God overcame the death, the fear, and the betrayal. Through Jesus Christ, we hear God say, I'm sorry, because we know that Jesus died upon the cross, and we know that God moved that moment beyond the cross to an empty cross, to a resurrected Christ, and a mountain that continues to be moved. We cannot move mountains alone, but we can move mountains. We can climb the ones that seem impossible to climb every day because we know a God that loves us, God is with us, God shows us, and God is not the mountain that often feels like it stands in our way. God is the one who has shown us the way. And God reminds us that God does not want us to be in pain and hurting. God wants us to know love. And therefore, we do pray. We pray as Jesus taught us. We pray to a God who loves us with our human needs and questions. We pray to a God who shows us that we can move mountains. And we remind ourselves that God has shown us the kingdom, the glory, and how the power lives forever.